So, what's up, guys? It's been a while. Which means I got a lot of catching up to do. And this video is going to be long, just to let you guys know. That I've been neglecting over the last month and a half, 2 months. There's a lot of things been going on in my life, whatever. I'm not going to go into my excuses. Let's just say that there's been a lot of things going on. I've had a promotion at work. I've had a new relationship going on. I've had my political action committee, yes, California, that's been going on. I've been involved with the California National Party. We've been hammering out our platform over the last couple months. So all these have kind of taken from my time to do YouTube and just in general my lack of just caring about a lot of, burnout from politics and stuff like that, particularly the U.S. politics sort of thing. I don't think it's any question. I think I may have spoken about it in the last video I did a while back or so, about just how I'm getting fucking done with U.S. politics, and it's not that I'm not going to be involved in U.S. politics or talk about it from time to time, but I think I am going to finally start moving kind of more towards centralizing along, you know, California-based politics, California independence-based politics, world events, stuff like that. And yes, I will still talk about things like BLM and other things going on and stuff like that in the future. I also will be releasing probably next week sometime, obviously next week because I got 10 days to do it, a 9/11 video that I do every year, obviously defending Muslims and Arabs. So that's still going to be a thing. I just am trying to find something to talk about, and I think what I'm going to be talking about is the whole issue with Eid and the fact that that celebration just happens this year to fall around September 11th. So I'll be probably talking about that. I probably will be producing a lot more Yes California content. I will be actually going, you know, I have a lot of things that I'll probably be trying to be involved with over the next couple of months. You know, I'm always constantly in contact with Louis Marinelli, who leads this campaign, and other people who are involved with the CNP and stuff like that. You know, I was chairman of the Rule of Law Committee during this platform thing the last couple of months, so that's kept me busy. So ultimately, I'm going to try to get back to doing videos again, because now that we're kind of approaching the end of that with the CNP moving forward with its with its positions, and Yes California continuing its fight, there'll probably be a lot more time for me to do stuff like that. And just in case I ever do have to go down in the future for a little while, I'll try to make videos letting you guys know if that happens. But there's a lot I need to cover, and this is why I said it's going to be a long video, because I'm going to try to hash this out into a big, long cover debate, basically, not debate, but cover the story, basically, of lots of different topics. And of course, the first topic I'm sure a lot of people currently want me to talk about first is the YouTube crite is over thing. I've used YouTube since 2009. As a user, anyway, like a person that used to comment on shit, I used to, you know, I think I joined YouTube in February of 2009, so I've been here for about 7 years. And I think I started doing content in about 2010, so I've been making videos for 6 years. And then I think NorCal Corner got started in about, I don't know, I want to say around 2011, 2012, so roughly my show, my NorCal Corner, this franchise that I've built, literally from jack shit, still is jack shit, but that I basically built from jack shittier foundations, has been going on for 4 to 5 years, and still will continue. But over that course of time, the 4 or 5 years, the 6 years, the 7 years that I've been a part of it, I have witnessed, as a YouTube user myself, the crumbling of this service, especially after Google bought it and has literally just ruined it, just completely taking it from this great video sharing service where everyone can have a say and have an opinion and post whatever they want within the confines of legal bourgeois legalism. It was a pretty good service for a while, and then Google took it over and has literally just bombed it to hell. And we've put up with a lot of crap, whether it was the fact that we had to have a Gmail service to a Gmail account to eat or sync our account to YouTube to have a YouTube thing, or that we had to have a Google Plus account to have YouTube, or whatever various other bullshit was involved. Now YouTube has changed its terms of service yet again, and this isn't just this whole thing about changing a video format and all that crap. YouTube has now done something that not only is going to affect the smaller YouTubers such as myself, but is going to affect even big YouTubers like Storm Clouds Gathering, Jacqueline Glenn, even PewDiePie, which, by the way, that joke dude on Twitter was fucking hilarious, that ISIS comment, holy hell. Anyway, all this aside, YouTube has basically now gone on this thing where in order to have your videos monetized, you have to make content that is advertiser friendly, and because apparently, you know, they want clean content that's not going to offend anybody that, you know, might be wanting to buy or sell products that happened to get advertised on this fucking thing. So that means that you can't even post, you can't even talk about sexual humor. So you can be talking even about not even sexual humor, just anything that basically disagrees with what they have to say. So you could even be talking about the Stanford rapist scumbag. And by the way, just talking about this, I'm probably not, you know, if I had a monetization on this, they'd probably demonetize this video. You could be talking about that and probably have your videos demonetized. Yet CNN, RT, mainstream media can go ahead and post whatever the fuck they want, and they won't get dinged. But any of us talk about it, we will. I think that speaks right there for the nature of capitalism and just outright corporate autocracy anyway. But let's just kind of think about that for a minute. We have had, I would say, the really gracious privilege of doing, of being able to produce our own content, and for some of us, make our own money off of our own content for years now. But when I say privilege, I mean privilege. That privilege no longer exists. If we actually still were able to do this, that would be our right. But we never had a right to our own content. We just had the privilege. That's over now. That's what this whole YouTube is over thing, as much as people don't want to admit it, that's what it really means. YouTube is over in the sense that our privileges are basically gone. And this shouldn't be surprising. That's the nature of capitalism. Ever since Google took over this service, it was destined to go to shit. Google bought YouTube back in about 2010, I believe it was. 2009, 2010, 2011, somewhere along in there. Which means that even the guys that started this don't even have a fucking say anymore. YouTube is no longer YouTube. It's GTube. It's GoogleTube. And I've said this, I think, since about, what, 2013? About four years? I said this a long time ago. And that's where we are. Now, I'm not on here to talk about this because I'm really affected that much. I never monetized my videos in the first place. In fact, I'm probably one of the last few people that don't and never have and never will monetize their videos now. Because I never really saw the reason to. Did I give it some thought? Yes. But have I actually ever gone ahead and done it? No. I came close, but never did. Because each time I kept thinking this would probably go against my convictions, my morals, and maybe in a little ways I was thinking down the line, what would happen later on down the line. And this was why I never did it. Because I knew something like this, or something to this nature, was going to happen eventually. And I'm glad I didn't. I'm really glad I stuck by my convictions and never did, because turns out I was right. Also kind of helps to listen to a few of my own Marxist community members, such as Jason Unruh. Although he's getting dinged pretty hard now, too, because literally what money he, like the bank that he used to make every month off of his videos, he's now making about a quarter of what he used to have. And I see that happening to not only just him, but other YouTubers. Like I said, this is not only just going to affect small-based YouTubers, this is actually going to affect even big YouTubers, like Mr. Repsion is going to be affected by this. PewDiePie will be affected by this. All these people that have used this service and have enjoyed making basically a livelihood off of doing YouTube, that's over. So basically, there's nothing more that we could really do. Sure, you could go ahead and sue Google, and if you win, what a miracle, that would be great. But really, in the end, is Google going to care? They make billions of dollars every day. They're not going to give a damn. But they're going to give a damn enough to send their big corporate lawyers to win the case so that they don't even have to pay a goddamn cent. And even if they do lose, do you think you'll ever see a bit of that money? Probably not. You could boycott YouTube, but what's that going to do? Some bourgeois legalist protest? That's not going to do anything. It's like YouTube, boycotting YouTube, boycotting Google. Google's just going to go, it's just a few people that don't like us. Who gives a damn? And not only that, if you really want to boycott YouTube, it's more than just boycotting a service, folks. You'd have to boycott the actual service. Go to Yahoo, I guess, the search engine. You'd have to boycott YouTube, which means everybody would have to take a pledge that they're no longer going to use YouTube and start using Dailymotion, I guess. You know, and then on top of that, any of you that have a Gmail account or a G Plus account, which if you use Google Plus, I'm good for you, I guess. I don't see anybody that really uses that, I guess, except for maybe a teleconference. I'd use that. That's the only thing I use it for. But yeah, you'd have to quit using Google Hangouts, Google Plus. You'd have to quit using, you'd have to delete your Gmail account. And for some of you, I know that's really fucking hard to do, considering even I have to agree that Gmail is probably about the best email service that I've had, and as a person that uses a Gmail service regularly. And it's not only that, you'd also have colleges. So if you go to a university, there are some colleges that use Gmail as their service. So what you going to do there? So, ultimately, boycotting's not going to work, suing them's probably not going to work, and ultimately, this is what Google knows. This is what Google CEOs know. There's not a damn thing we can do about it. Just like time and time again, we basically had to just sit back and just basically let this happen. Because we have no other choice. We have no other, I mean, the only alternative is basically we go somewhere else, and really, again, we have very limited options for that, be it Dailymotion or whatever, and I hate to say it, but Dailymotion servers, I've tried uploading a few videos there, and their servers aren't quite adequate, as I would put it. So, ultimately, this is really a sad thing. Because those of us that have become very used to and very pretty much accustomed to the YouTube service now have to come to the sad realization that Google has effectively killed it. And I don't know what this means for the future of YouTube or for the future of a lot of us that still use it, but this definitely means that we're going to have to, you know, brace ourselves for the next chapter. And sad as it's, and I wish I had something positive to say about it, and hopefully there is something positive that can come out of this, but right now, it's going to be a long, dark road ahead. So, that's what I have to say about YouTube. Still maintaining the dark path that we're still on, might as well go ahead and jump into the rigged Democratic National Convention thing that happened about a month or so ago. Again, kind of slacked off on a lot of stuff because for a while I haven't really given a crap. I've talked about it on social media, but never really actually given a crap to actually post a video about it because... But essentially, as everybody should know by now, and if you don't, well... pay the fuck attention. Hillary Clinton is the Democratic national nominee. Shocker. It's not a shocker to a lot of us, even for those of us that endorsed Bernie Sanders. It's not a shocker. The Democrats had her pegged from the beginning and threw every ounce of cash they had to get her elected. Even went so far as to rig an election to make sure she was elected. And, in fact, numerous sources and even electoral commissions have even said that without rigging an election, without voter fraud, Hillary Clinton could never have actually succeeded in winning the primaries. And, of course, you know, the Republican nominee is Donald Trump. I mean, that was pretty much obvious from the get-go as well. Pretty much obvious since at least May of this year when Ted Cruz prematurely ejected himself. But, yeah. Basically, it's Hillary versus Donald. So, basically now, whoever the fuck ends up in the White House, we basically will, one, have successfully gone black and gone back. Two, we're going to have an old white man as president. Both are sarcastic jokes, in case you didn't get the metaphors. And essentially, we're fucked either way. There's people that want to jump on the Jill Stein bandwagon because she's trying to steal the Bernie Sanders our revolution, saying, oh, we're going to continue what he started. Whatever. It doesn't really fucking matter. Third parties in this country don't fucking matter. Unless you actually can throw enough support behind her to get her into at least the debates, then that's one thing. And that's is possible, but the possibility of her actually winning the general election is pretty slim to none. Because America is not a multi-party sort of social democratic sort of nation like a lot of places in Europe, be it France, Germany, even though it's currently under a conservative government right now, Iceland to a better extent. You know, these are all nations that actually have multi-party democracies. The United States has basically a one-party, two-ideology system in which you have the two ideological organizations, the Democrats and the Republicans, but all basically are for the same things. Statism, corporatism, capitalism. They're all basic. These two groups run for your control, basically. There is no real election. Your voice really doesn't matter. That's bourgeois parliamentarianism. That's the nature of a capitalistic democracy. You do not have representation. You know who has representation? Corporations. That's it. Corporations are the first-class citizens. The second-class citizens are basically the general people. Proletariat, and generally the people that have at least more of that privilege in this society typically tend to be white, male, Christians, heterosexual. They typically tend to have more of the privilege in this society. The third class citizens would obviously be women, gays, ethnic minorities, essentially you get the point there. And those are also, again, the general proletariat. Those are the people that basically aren't even second class, but I would consider third class citizens in this country. Not outright stating that as my own point of view, I'm stating that as an observation. And the problem with this is that we have a system that is basically exploiting that continues to base itself off of this sort of nature. And people wonder how we can change it. Well, Marxists have been saying how you can change it. Socialists have been saying how you can change this. Get rid of the system. But people don't seem to understand that. You can't actually take it upon yourself to organize as a general proletariat against the ruling class. But no one in the first world is going to do that. So, what do we do? Well, basically, you sit back and watch as this corrupt sort of oligarchy continues to destroy everyone and itself internally. Because eventually, that flame of tyranny is eventually going to burn itself out eventually. Mainly because it cannot continue to survive under its own idiocies and, frankly, it's just not sufficient. It cannot continue to be sufficient. So, eventually, that's going to lead to pretty much what I would equate to how the situation in Greece went down about a year or two ago. When they were facing their, and still are facing, economic ruin, we're basically going to have to go one of three ways. And I see it kind of already beginning as we approach the general election 2 months from now in the U.S. We can basically go the route of socialism, which means basically we nationalize everything, we get rid of, we start demonopolizing things, we, you know, start regulating capitalism to the point where basically, to the point where we're able to redistribute the wealth, we're able to have ownership of businesses and these private enterprises in the hands of the working class proletariat. That's one way we can go. And given the McCarthyist still sentiment of the United States, I really don't see that as a viable option, except maybe in the younger crowd. So maybe it's possible in the future, but currently I don't really see it happening. The other way is basically Keynesianism or neoliberalism, which is much far rather likely, especially under Clinton. Which basically isn't American liberalism, it's essentially more libertarianism, liberal conservatism, if at best. Or basically what her husband put into place about in the 90s with help of other kind of capitalistic philosophers. Third way, which is basically centrism and syncretic, you know, bourgeois nationalism and, you know, fiscal conservatism, you know, economic responsibility. And that's great. That's one way, you know, that's one way of trying to at least solve an economic system, but in the process it's basically social tyranny. Essentially, it's trying to create all these, try to create certain reforms, give certain concessions to, back to the people, but essentially the system itself still remains the same. So basically what happened under Obama would continue under Clinton. Some people are for that, some people think there needs to be more radical change. Me being one of those for radical change. Much radical. The other way is where a lot of people are going with Trump, and given 40% of his consumer base being white supremacists and fascists. And that's where I'm getting to on that. Is America will end up getting to a point where they will either go the last two routes of neoliberalism or socialism, or go towards fascism. Now, I've already stated it a few times, my opinions when it comes down to Clinton and Trump, that basically you're voting for soft or hard fascism, essentially statism, corporatism against Nazism, which all basically is almost the same thing. Go into another lecture on the different, on the slight differences at a later time, but let's just focus on this right now. With the economic fallout that has gone over the years, even though we've had, you know, some job growth, unemployment is down, etc., the state of the social situation of America is continuously deteriorating. And economics and social progress do not necessarily have to culminate in the same thing. Your economy could be rebounding or doing well or even better than it was, but your social norms, are your social status, the way that things are, your whether it be at racial issues, you know, human rights abuses or human rights issues such as LGBT rights, etc., if those things could seriously be deteriorating, even if your economy is good. They could also be deteriorating if your economy is bad, or your economy is stagnating or stabilized. Doesn't matter. One doesn't necessarily have another thing to do with the other. But this is the this is what separates what is our biggest difference yet similarity that we have with Greece. Our economy is rebounding, but our social situation is continuously and greatly deteriorating day by day. The police killings that continue to go on, and frankly the white privilege denial of such issues that I've witnessed myself from friends of mine, so-called friends of mine. It's these situations that have continued to deteriorate, and obviously nothing being done about it. I'll get into the Colin Kaepernick thing in a few minutes. But essentially, we're deteriorating down a path where essentially there's this extremist rise that's been going on for several years now, but is getting much worse. And I think that because we are seeing that, this is also why we're seeing a deterioration or separation of the Bernie Sanders Democrats that are leaving it in droves, going towards the Green Party or trying to form their own separate entities, etc. When you have extremist violence and extremist rhetoric, such as Donald Trump supporters, or just plain Donald Trump, you're going to have that opposition, and that's what we're also seeing. Because with every action, there's an opposite reaction. And so we're basically faced with this situation that I don't really see socialism being the thing that comes about. It can, in the form of social democracy, which is essentially a softer form of Keynesianism, but I really see it basically going that neoliberalist route, or fascist route. And I think that this is the sad thing we have to acknowledge in America, is that we are basically going to try one or the other, and if one fails, we're going to go with the other. It's hard to say whether or not we're going to vote for Donald Trump, whether or not Donald Trump will get in or whether Hillary Clinton will get in. Personally, it keeps rebounding, and I can't say for certain myself as a person that lives in an occupied nation under the United States. Basically, if it goes the route of Hillary Clinton, I see that the social situations might improve, but who knows? There's also a likelihood that if that fails, that people are going to turn further towards fascism. And considering the situation after the Bernie Sanders fallout, I'm kind of more concerned about the fact that because people haven't necessarily given socialism or even social democracy a chance and think that, oh, that's failed, well, now what's our alternative? Well, some people even have turned to Trump, and that's the problem. America is essentially now turning towards a very fascist, or at least very least quasi-fascist sort of situation in this country. If Hillary Clinton gets in, that's one thing. That's something that I'm sure some people can tolerate for a few more years. I don't know if I can stomach that myself, but let's just put it into a more non-personal, objective standpoint. It's basically a choice between, do you want a phalangist Mussolini, like a Franco-esque, Mussolini-esque sort of person in Hillary Clinton, or do you want a Mussolini-Hitler version of Donald Trump in office? Either way, it's not good, because essentially the U.S. is going down this route where corporate monopoly, corporatism, statism, it's going to get worse. Nationalism is going to get worse. The patriotism with certain people is going to increase, and we're actually even seeing how Americans are getting more and more xenophobic, more racist. They're getting more Islamophobic than we were after 9/11. People are getting, it's just getting very much to this point where America as itself is essentially imploding on itself. Now, that's probably a controversial statement for a lot of Americans to hear, a shocking statement to hear, but for some people that might watch these videos outside of the community, outside of the American way of life, this probably isn't as surprising as to you, but, whatever. Essentially, America is imploding on itself. It is literally a dying star. Donald Trump makes these statements, make America great again. Well, when was America ever really great? You could make the argument, well, America was great, in such and such time. yeah, back in such and such time when it was still oppressing the rights of Asian Americans or black people, which it still does, when it was basically genocidally raping and killing and stealing the land of the natives that lived here, or occupying lands that didn't, and nations that didn't belong to them. Basically, imperialism, genocide, murder, all kinds of human rights abuses and war crimes, frankly, that it's committed over the years. When was it ever great? That's the thing that needs to be first and foremost said. America was never great. It once was an economic superpower, but that did not necessarily make it a great and, you know, any sort of generous nation, because obviously the way that it came about its economic height was through its own oppression of other people, because that's the nature of capitalism and imperialism. But ultimately, the U.S. itself is a dying star. And I think that this is why I'm going to go back on another California nationalist, you know, tangent just for a second. This is also why I think California is starting to rise as an economic superpower, and why I think that essentially the U.S. as an entity, and this is what I've mentioned to friends over the last month and a half, America is basically, as an entity, will eventually die out. That's the way I see it going. I don't think that it can sufficiently sustain itself socially or even economically into the next 50 years. And I think what's going to happen, and this is, again, these are theories and prophecies and premonitions that I've made in the past that 95% of the time, I would say, actually, I was usually somewhat right on. And here's my theory. The United States of America, as it currently stands, will most likely in the next 50 years become, as an entity, little more than maybe a European Union, where it might have an economic pact with certain former states turned nations. It might have some sort of military alliance. There might be states with military alliances. There might, you know, political alliances, whatever you want to call it. All these things, like a NATO-esque EU sort of thing, where these people are allied. They're still, you know, American in, you know, in a allied set sort of way, but they're their own nations. So if essentially what all these Bundy idiots and, you know, even loose-leafed sort of like neoliberal and libertarian sort of people talk about when it comes to state sovereignty, essentially that, but instead of state sovereignty, it's outright autonomy and sovereignty itself, nation-state status. And these, you know, and I see this happening with a lot of, you know, possibly with a lot of southern states, New England states like Vermont, New York, you know, groups like that. I see some of these states obviously having sort of like these international pacts. California, on the other hand, I don't see being part of that, because the group I'm with, the group and groups that I'm involved with, we are trying to kind of separate ourselves as peacefully and as, you know, as you know, basically we're trying to more self-identify ourselves as being more of a Pacific nation, more as being our own sort of entity, separate from the rest of the U.S. And I think Texas is also going to kind of do the same, but I also see Texas kind of in an American sort of alliance like that. But these are all offshoot sort of theories and tangents I could go into, and I could go into separately at a later time. But that's my theory. I think America as an entity within the next 20 to 50 years will probably be broken up into several sort of independent nations or collectives where basically the sense of a U.S. entity would be nothing more than an EU-style, you know, and NATO pact, basically. So, but essentially, it's the whole fact that the U.S., as an actual nation-state, will cease to exist. And so then, and when I mentioned the whole thing about California surpassing France the sixth largest economy in the world, these are also facts. I believe it was through Business Insider that released the thing on June 14th, California Independence Day, that California surpassed France as the sixth largest economy. I think I mentioned this before, but essentially we were at 10th, then 8th, then 6th, and our economy over the last couple years has been significantly rebounding, and I think that California over the next 25 years will most likely end up becoming the next world superpower. I think after China runs its course, the Asian market runs its course, essentially California will eventually come into its own. And, I mean, we're still talking a lot of things in our own independence movement about, you know, whether we should form a stock market and any of these things, all insignificant right now. But essentially, California will end up becoming its own entity probably within the next half century. Whether that's in a sovereign standpoint or even, or at least in a more sort of a devolution, more autonomous, prosperous sort of aspect, California will eventually surpass even the United States. And I see this happen, and so I make that motion along with the whole idea of the U.S. and its crumbling, you know, basically the U.S. itself just crumbling. So all that ties in politics, theory, future, we're fucked, essentially sort of ramble. And then, of course, I wanted to talk about the Colin Kaepernick sort of situation. There's a few other things I could talk about. The Stanford kid getting out of jail. Fuck you, dude. There's a lot of things. The hurricane that's about to hit Florida. Everyone, please stay safe. Get the hell out if you can. But the Colin Kaepernick situation, of course, is a big issue that I need to touch upon. I'm a 49ers fan. Not shocking, I'm from NorCal. I'm also a Chargers fan. Not shocking, because I'm from California itself. So, some people think I'm being biased in this situation, but my sports bias has very little to do with it, considering the very fact that the NFL I don't really watch much anymore because it has been corrupted by capitalism. And I really just don't care to watch it that much anymore because of the very nature of it being about as rigged as a Hillary Clinton election. It's the Colin Kaepernick situation is over the fact that this one individual, who, by the way, has benefited off of the system that he, you know, and has been exploited, you know, has exploited and been exploited by the very nature of the system that he claims to be against. We'll side that for this video, but at least good to mention it. The man sat out during the national anthem, the special song of the patriotic U.S., and people got very offended by his actions, but did not really take into account why he did that. And even if they did, they typically tend to ignore it because, you know, white privilege, white colonizer mentality, and just outright fucking racism. Colin Kaepernick sat out during the national anthem because he stated, and I'm paraphrasing, that he would not stand and salute, basically salute a nation that continues to oppress the rights of people of color, particularly African Americans. And I agree with him. By all rights, he has that right to do so. In fact, even certain veterans have come out and said that they fought for his right to say what they want, even if they don't necessarily agree with him. And if quite a few veterans themselves are saying that, even while some others do not, that should at least speak and resonate throughout the rest of the interlink. But unfortunately, it doesn't. People tend to forget that there are actually veterans that support Colin Kaepernick, or at least support his right to do what he did. I stand for his message, because, let's face it, there is racial tension, and as I said, there's a very social fabric deterioration in the United States that is eventually going to crumble it. And the fact that there are people out there that are getting pissed because he did not stand for this, you know, this song, you know, and did not stand up to respect his country, do not seem to understand the situation of why he did it. And the man is basically standing up, be it a bourgeois, legalist, peaceful protest, liberal protest. He did it in his own way. He did it, and he did it with grace, and didn't basically try to shove it down everybody's throats like, you know, a lot of Americans would with their views. He just basically, the man just sat down in silence. And for some reason, people have a problem with that. You know, you can have politicians that do this all the time. You can have Donald Trump, who doesn't stand and, you know, and salute his country during the Pledge of Allegiance, be it he will stand and salute during the national anthem, but he won't stand for certain things. And all that's fine. You know, there's people that protest that won't stand during the national anthem, won't stand during the Pledge of Allegiance. That's fine, be it even some a little bits of controversy, but usually generally not really, just generally overlooked. Colin Kaepernick, a man of mixed race, who is part African American, does so for a legitimate reason to stand up for the rights of people of color, and all of a sudden everyone loses their fucking shit. That's white privilege. That's white colonizer mentality. And if I may be so bold to add on, that's white supremacy. And this is something that I have said for quite a lot. Now, I also speak as a person who's a California nationalist. Nationalism in itself is not necessarily a bad thing. It can actually be used for greater good. But for a lot of us that are on the left-wing nationalist sentiment, such as a California nationalist who's a Marxist, once you reach your goal objective, and this is also what the general California, Yes, California group is for, we wish to obtain nation-state status. Once nation-state status has been achieved, that nationalism goal slides silently to the tides of history. Because what is the point of nationalism when you already have your nation? What is the point of continuing a nationalist ideology when you already have that nation? It's time to leave that behind and roll out your actual platform, your ideological platform. Whether it's, you know, and frankly, shared ideological platform, because you need opposition and you need people on your side and all that other good shit in between. But for a lot of people on the right wing, that doesn't happen. And even in the neoliberal sect, it doesn't happen. The problem with nationalism is that it does corrode movements if it does not, and corrodes whole nations if not left, you know, in the past. Nationalism will corrupt eventually. And if you mix that with patriotism, which is most, in pretty much almost 95% of the cases, is outright right-wing extremism, or right-wing-esque anyway. You combine nationalism with patriotism, you get quasi-fascism, if not outright just fascism itself. That's a big problem. And see, I find it a little bit hypocritical and ironic that so-called liberals who fight for racial equality, that say that they're going to stand up and fight for, you know, I'm going to fight for your rights, I'm going to help you, da 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 da. Colin Kaepernick does this one thing, and all of a sudden their racism shines like a beacon in the fucking harbor. And these are the same people that said, oh, I'm with the BLM, I sympathize with them, blah, 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 blah. You know, I'm with them, da 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 da. Colin Kaepernick stands up, fuck you, dude, you're disrespecting our flag, you're disrespecting our nation. And that's a complete and utter fucking contradiction. And essentially, that's a contradiction of pretty much liberalism with nationalism and patriotism. It's okay to be a nationalist up to a point. It's okay to be a patriot up to a point. You know, that's fine. Keep your, you know, you can have those views. There's nothing wrong with it. When those two mix, however, it becomes very dangerous. It can become very dangerous. And you try to mix it with the liberals who try to say, oh, I'm with this, you know, I stand up for social justice and da 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 da. And yet their bourgeois nationalism comes out. Their patriotism comes out. And then all of a sudden, everything just does a complete 180. So there's a lot of contradiction. There's a lot of irony. There's just a lot of blatant hypocrisy coming from so-called liberals. And so that's important to point out as well. It's just this whole situation has been blown out of complete proportion over what is simply an act of bourgeois liberal activism. The man has done nothing wrong. He simply sat down during a damn song. And he sat down because he did not want to salute a piece of fucking fabric. I'm sorry if that offends a lot of you, but that is simply what it is. Do you think that the Egyptians are that overly nuts over their national anthem and their piece of fabric? No. Do you think that the Iraqis are? Do you think that even the British, with their history of imperialism and nationalism over theirs, aren't even as fucking crazed as Americans are? So people are going to get pissed at me for making these statements, and I don't care. The purpose of this video, especially as we approach 9/11, is the fact that so many people get so worked up over a flag and over a song that when faced with someone that's actually taking a stand for social activism, some sort of process towards achieving racial, you know, fighting for racial equality, they're basically cast to the side and basically said that they're agitators, that they're too radical, you know, terrorists even, you know, especially if they're Arab. They're labeled all these sort of things. And yet, politicians, particularly in, let's just broaden that up, white people, typically tend to stand up for similar things, and yet they don't face the same harshness. But let's be honest, anytime you basically take a stand against the national anthem or the flag, you're basically labeled as un-American. And again, that brings back this whole tie-in about nationalism and patriotism and why that is basically equatable to quasi-fascism. And I think it's funny, because I saw on Facebook, I think it was, about three or four days ago, there is something that says that if you want to go to have a nation where you have to mandatorily salute your flag, go to North Korea. Now, I could also talk a lot about, you know, things about that, but for the sake of the joke, I'm going to leave it alone because it's hilariously funny. Because essentially, if you don't, it's basically a reaction to the people that basically, the typical American reaction that, oh, if you don't like our country, you can get out. If you don't like the flag, you can get out. If you don't like our national anthem, essentially, if you don't believe what I believe, you can leave. which is just a very, again, typical national, ultra-nationalist American thing, American exceptionalist thing to say. So the fact that this was saying that, you know, if you don't, that if you want to mandatorily salute a flag and basically be a sheep, go to a country that does this all the time. You know, so, and I think there might have been one about Iran, too. Ultimately, this whole situation with Colin Kaepernick, I'm tired of hearing about it, and the only reason I'm talking about it now is to basically get my views out there, because I know that there's a few things that people have been waiting for me to talk about, and I just wanted to get my views out there. So again, all I can say is, you know, when it comes down to it, can we all just learn to fucking get along? Can we, you know, learn to be human beings? And can we please make better decisions on who the hell we have in our, have governing our countries? Can we please do a better job at putting politicians into office? And can we please get rid of these people that throw money and money and money into the equation to distort and rob us of any sort of free individuality, democracy, what have you, human rights, etc. It's like, can we please learn to evolve into some sort of decency and intellectual evolution? Like, can we, because otherwise we're basically doomed to repeat our history. We're doomed to repeat a lot of different things. I was talking to a friend, I'm going to make this a closing statement. I was talking to a friend yesterday about the system of the American political system and how it evolved, how the Democrats basically evolved from this racist and conservative sort of bunch, which, you know, to progressives and stuff like that because of the splintering of radical liberal Republicans that formed the progressive movement. Democrats formed with them, the tides changed, now the Republicans are the racists and the conservatives, and the liberals were, to a point, progressives and liberals. And now we're seeing that tide change again. So I went into that whole thing about that. There is definitely a shift in the politics of America today. There's definitely a shift going on that I think is also playing a big part in where our country's going, and eventually, I think, and like I said, eventually leading to our country's towards American deterioration. There's a lot of things that are going to happen over the coming years and decades, folks, and there's, and for the most part, we're just going to have to ride the fucking bitch until the wheels fall off. You know, we're just going to have to ride this crazy train to wherever destination it goes. Nothing we can really do about it. I mean, we can change certain paths. We can definitely change the way we go down that path. But there's not a whole lot of way we can steer clear of where we're going. Our destiny is our destiny. Our future is our future. It's where we're going to go. It's hard to tell what that future is going to be like. And it's hard to tell where, you know, it's really hard to tell what our world is going to be like in the next, you know, 10 minutes, much less 10 years. You know, the next 20 minutes and 20 years, 50 minutes, the next hour and the next 100 years. It's hard to say. All I can say is that for the here and now, we need to learn to become better human beings, because if we don't, we ain't gonna be here in the next 10 minutes, 10 years, 20 minutes. You know, we won't be here for it. Because if we don't change, we are doomed to create our own destruction. I think that's a good little fire and brimstone little thing to end on. I'm NorCal Nick, leader of the revolutionist movement, and this has been NorCal Corner.